Thank you very much, Paul. Yeah, and thank you very much for the organizers for putting up this conference, for the determination to have it despite all the difficulties. And yeah, and thanks a lot for having me here as a speaker. So the work I'm going to tell you about is a joint work with Patricia Contreras-Tejada and Carlos Palazuelos. And yes, and well, the title has changed a bit from what it was originally planned, as with many other talks, because, well, the views and the results we have here have changed from a year ago or so. And actually, part of the work here, it has already been published in this paper here. And I'm going to talk about the results in this paper, but also about some ongoing work that we're doing now. Okay. So, well, my motivation is pretty standard, and I guess everybody shares this motivation. So the preparation of entangled states involving many parties plays a crucial role in this, in our field, and we would like to have ways to have them in experiments, right? Well, what I'm going to talk about here, so what this implies is that in principle, when this might be really costly and complicated experimentally, you must have access to many parties and be able to entangle them and distribute these parties to distances and so on. So the kind of situation I'm going to consider here is arguably and experimentally maybe more feasible way to do so. This doesn't require to jointly access all parties, but only to distribute entangled pairs among different parties, okay? So this is why I say arguably, this is maybe a more feasible way experimentally to do these things. So what I consider here, and this is what I call bipartite state networks, is, well, I have many parties and they might share bipartite entanglement, okay? So we just distribute bipartite entanglement via node-to-node protocols. So for instance, and then I can represent any state by a graph, okay? So for this, in this example, what we see is a six-party bipartite state networks, okay? So wherever we have an edge, it means that those parties share an entangled bipartite state, okay? And if they don't share entanglement, if they share some separable state, then I don't write the edge. So the edge assumes that they share some bipartite entangled state. And then, well, the node, each vertex represents a party. I mean, of course, if you look at here, party three shares, well, one particle from the state she shares with five, one particle from the state she shares with four, and one particle from the state she shares with two. But well, I only write there one vertex, the local dimension, and then she might share many different particles that with other parties, okay? Okay, so this is the kind of states we are going to look into in this work. And well, I would like to maybe start by asking ourselves the question. So, okay, this is a very particular class of n-partite states because we are not entangling, we are not accessing jointly all parties, but just distributing entanglement among particle pairs. Is the preparation of such n-partite states sufficient for all purposes? So maybe what I mean here is if some experimentalist group reported tomorrow that they have that they can do this, that they have the ability to entangle particle pairs with whatever number of parties at whatever distance, with whatever quality of bipartite entanglement. The only motivation is that they can only entangle particle pairs. How happy should we be? Okay, so I think the answer is that we should be extremely happy. This, in principle, would be, even though this is a restricted class of states, this is sufficient for all purposes. Why? Because, well, provided we work under the standard LOCC paradigm, okay? Because if this is the case, then, and provided the quality of node-to-node entanglement is good enough, then for any n-partite state can be prepared from such a network. Okay, so in order to convince yourself of this, there's a very simple argument. If the bipartite entanglement here is maximally entangled states of sufficiently large dimension, then one of the parties can locally prepare the target state that you want and then start teleporting in such a way that at the end of the day, all the parties share the given state. So for instance, three could prepare the six partite target state and then teleports using this connection two particles to 5, who then teleports one particle to 6, and so on. Okay. So in principle, this kind of states, if the node-to-node entanglement is good enough, and if we have LOCC, then this would be as powerful as anything. Okay, nevertheless, recent works have shown limitations of these schemes if some of other restrictions are added. Okay? So for instance, we have this work from Yamasaki, Pirken, Murao, Bolmandura, and Barbara Krauss that show that if the dimensionality of node-to-node entanglement is limited, so they cannot share arbitrarily high dimensional states, then there are multipartite states that cannot be prepared by LOCC from the network, yet they can be obtained from a single multipartite state, which is consistent with the local dimensionality restriction. So in this case, if you have this restriction, there is somehow something more powerful about having a multipartite state, which is not a bipartite state network. And then another set of works that have studied limitations in this context is here in the second point, in which somehow what they assume is that the state manipulation is limited, so they cannot do full LOCC. So in many situations, what they consider here is that they can do any local operations, they can use shared randomness, but they don't have access to classical communication. Okay? This is, for instance, the setting of this paper here by Navasquez and collaborators. And also, there's this paper by Kraft and collaborators, which was actually a talk yesterday, in which they were considering also the preparation of states where only some form of local operations is possible. Okay, so when this happens, then it can be shown that not any multipartite state can be prepared from a bipartite state network. For instance, as Tristan Kraft was showing yesterday, the GHZ state cannot be prepared in this way. From a three-partite bipartite state network. So in a sense, so this, I think all these studies are interesting because somehow they study limitations to these bipartite state networks schemes. If somehow we are somehow limited, and then we can study better to what extent we can achieve certain things and what things are impossible. Actually, also another interesting thing about these studies is that these approaches can be used by experimentalists who want to prove their strength to entangle beyond particle pairs. So if they really want to convince someone that they can do something more that share node-to-node entanglement, well, this can be done by somehow using the conditions here. Of course, if the above restrictions can be assured to hold, if the experimentalists, the parties can classically communicate, then these conditions here do not hold true anymore. And also an interesting thing of this approach, in particular of the second, is somehow this has a clear notion of free operations, which instead of LOCC is LO plus shared randomness, and then allows to study this idea of beyond bipartite entanglement in the standard formalism of quantum research theories. Okay, but despite these works, the work that I want to present here somehow takes a complementary approach, okay, to these aforementioned references. So actually, instead of finding limitations of bipartite state networks by restricting LOCC, so what we want to do here is, assuming the LOCC paradigm holds, we want to understand the power of these states, okay? So this is, in principle, a useful way to generate multipartite states, and we want to understand their power in more detail. Want to understand to which extent can bipartite state networks display genuinely multipartite quantum features, such as entanglement and non-locality, under the, as I was saying, the full power of the LOCC paradigm, but depending on the quality of the bipartite entanglement shared by the nodes, and depending on the network topology. So looking more into these schemes in a positive way and see how useful they are and how far we can go with them. And as I hope I will convince you by the end of the talk, another reason to do this is that in bipartite state networks somehow constitute an operationally motivated subclass of multipartite states, which have a well-defined mathematical structure that, as we're going to see, somehow offer a rich playground to study the complex phenomenology of entanglement and non-locality in many body systems. Okay, so this is my motivation. I want to get a bit more precise and give some definitions, and in particular to address which genuine multipartite features I'm referring to here. Okay, so the paradigm we're going to use here is biseparability versus genuine multipartite entanglement, and bilocality versus genuine multipartite non-locality. So sorry that I missed Nicolas Brunner's talk yesterday because I was teaching, but so we consider here like genuine, somehow the network structure is just a way for us to prepare multipartite states. So we don't consider that this geometry is somehow enforced in our problem. So we are not going to consider network non-locality from the perspective of Nicolas' talk, because the network is not there. For us, it's just a means to prepare states. And then at the end of the day, independently of how they were prepared, what we want to see is whether do we have genuine multipartite features or not among all the parties. And this is why we check for genuine multipartite entanglement of genuine multipartite non-locality. Okay, which I will define precisely in a minute. Okay, but just, okay, so setting the notation I'm going to use throughout the talk. N will always denote the number of parties. Okay, so my Hilbert space is going to be the n-fold tensor product of local Hilbert spaces. Then I'm going to denote with this symbol, n in between square brackets, the set of the first n natural numbers. Okay, and here's the definition of biseparability and GME. This is something that has appeared already in the conference, but just to make sure. So we say that an n-partite U state is biseparable if it factorizes along some bipartition. Okay. If this is not possible, then we say that it is genuinely multipartite. It doesn't factorize across any bipartition. And then we extend this definition to mixed states by taking the convex hull of these sets, okay? So an n-partite state is biseparable if it can be written as a mixture of pure biseparable states, which could be along different bipartitions, okay? So in principle, any biseparable state takes this form, where all the states corresponding to a given bipartition are separable in that bipartition, okay? Good. Okay, so I think that the notion of genuine multipartite entanglement is what better suits here because of what we are saying. And actually, well, notice that in a particular setting, if we just consider bipartite state networks, then a biseparable bipartite state network could be prepared by LOCC by mixing disconnected networks. Okay, so for instance, in this simple case with three parties, if this triangle network is biseparable, then we can obtain it by LOCC from this pool of disconnected networks. Okay, so somehow the biseparable bipartite state networks do not include and genuinely entanglement among all its constituents. Okay. Moreover, since the set of biseparable states is closed by LOCC, then if my bipartite state network is biseparable, then no GME state can be obtained by it by LOCC. And hence somehow this state is going to be useless for any application that requires genuine multipartite entanglement. Okay, before I was talking about quantum resource theories, when one thinks of this biseparability versus genuine multipartite entanglement as a quantum resource theory, this is sometimes a bit problematic because it doesn't have the standard structure of a resource theory. The reason is that the set of biseparable states, which is what would be the set of free states in this resource theory, is not closed under tensor products. Okay, so this is something that is going to happen here as well. But actually, I'd like to convince you that this is somehow natural in the context of bipartite state networks. Okay, because, well, of course, if you think of this triangle network in which all the pairs share some entangled state, then of course this can be considered as the tensor product of these three disconnected networks, which are biseparable. But of course, this makes sense that if I take these three together, these three things together, then I get this network, which is not going to be biseparable, even though each of these three factors are biseparable. Yeah. And actually, what is much more natural here in the context of bipartite state networks is because another thing that could happen is by taking copies of a biseparable state, a state becomes GME. Okay? And if this happens with mixed bipartite state networks, which I already advanced to you that it happens, this is not that unnatural or surprising. It's kind of natural from this point of view, because if you think sharing many copies of a particular bipartite state network, this actually you can think of it as a network with the same topology in which just I share more copies of the bipartite entanglement. Okay, so you see, by taking copies, I'm increasing the quality of node-to-node entanglement. So it is not surprising that even though one copy of this might be useless, that more copies of it become useful because I have a better quality of entanglement among the nodes. And as I already advanced, this is something that happens actually. Okay, so I already addressed one of the properties we are interested in, the question of GME versus biseparability in bipartite state networks. The other question we are interested in is whether our networks display genuine multipartite non-locality. Okay. So, well, let me also define these things, although I guess many of you are familiar with these concepts. So then what we consider is the conditional probability distributions arising for performing measurements on some n-partite state, performing local measurements, in which the party I has inputs xi and outputs ai. Okay. So once we have these conditional probability distributions, similarly to the definition of biseparability, we say that it's bilocal. That is, it is not genuine multipartite non-local, GMNL for short, if it cannot be written as a convex combination of conditional probability distributions that factorize across some bipartition. Okay. Where, in addition of these objects here being conditional probability distributions, we are going to impose that they are non-signaling. Actually, for those who know about these things, Svetlicny's original definition in the late 80s of genuine multipartite non-locality leaves these distributions unrestricted, okay, as long as they are conditional probability distributions. But later work has shown that this can lead to operational problems. Actually, it's common to work within the framework of non-signaling distribution, and this is also what we are going to do here. So in order for a distribution to be GMNLE, not only it has to factorize in this way, but these distributions here have to be non-signaling. And well, and then of course, we are going to say that a state is GMNL if there exists measurements on it that lead to a GMNL conditional probability distribution. Okay, so let me start by discussing with a bit of an example, the power of bipartite state networks, okay? This, well, I'm not claiming any originality here for this observation. This is a very simple observation and actually a well-known observation. But what happens is that if we have a bipartite state connected network in which all the nodes share pure entanglement, this state is for sure GME. Okay? This will always be genuine multipartite entanglement, genuinely multipartite entanglement, no matter what is the amount of entanglement in the nodes, no matter how weak it is, as long as you have some entanglement in pure form. Also, no matter what the topology of the network is, then any connected network is going to lead to a GME state. This is actually very easy to prove because if you consider any reduced state, since the network is connected, at some point you will cross some edge. So this means that the reduction there has some mixed state into it. Okay? They cannot be perfectly pure, and hence that state cannot factorize in any bipartition because you always cross some edge. What it is not clear, and this is one of the questions with which this work started, is what happens for non-locality. So if they share, if we have any connected network in which nodes share pure entanglement, is this enough to lead to genuine multipartite non-locality or not? Okay, so then before getting into this question, let me discuss a bit with you what was known before about non-locality for pure states. Okay? The first result is an old result by Gisan from 1991, which is now known as Gisan's theorem, which establishes that any, in the bipartite case, any pure entangled states displays non-locality. Okay? There exist measurements such that we can obtain a non-local probability distribution. Actually, this result was sooner extended to the multipartite case, and showing that any pure GME state is not fully local, okay, which is not the same as being genuinely multipartite non-local, because this is being bilocal. Being fully local means that this probability is factorized for each party, okay. So this is a much weaker notion. Okay? Actually, so the extension of Gisan's theorem to the genuine multipartite regime is open. So the question of are all pure GME states GMNL, genuinely multipartite non-local, it's not known. There are several partial results around. We know that all three qubit pure states that are GME are GMNL, that all symmetric n qubit states that are GME are GMNL, but the question in general is open. And if one considers Gisan's theorem in the context of networks, this is a question with which I started a couple of slides ago, are all pure bipartite state networks GMNL? Then, well, to the best of my knowledge, what was known before is that this is the case for star networks. This means networks in which there is a central node which has an edge with all the remaining nodes. And if the network has this topology, and if the links correspond to maximally entangled states, then these states are GMNL. Okay, so this is what was known before. So now I'm in the position to present our results. This corresponds to those that have already been published in the reference I was giving at the beginning of my talk. So our first result that I'm going to call theorem one is that the answer to the question I was posing is yes. Okay? Any connected pure bipartite state network is GMNL as well as in the GME case, independently of the amount of entanglement shared, no matter how small the entanglement is, what the network topology is, as long as all the links correspond to pure entanglement and the network is of course connected, this will display GMNL. And the second result we have in that paper, I'm going to call theorem two, is actually we use this first result to try to give some answer in the direction of Gisan's theorem for genuine multipartite states. So we can answer that in a certain sense, all pure GME states display genuine multipartite non-locality. But in order to prove this, what we need is a finite number of copies of the state. So in more detail, what we prove is that given an n-partite GME state, then there is a finite number of copies of this state, which actually, we know it is sufficient to have n minus one, n being the number of parties. And then these states lead to genuine multipartite non-local distributions. Okay, so these are the main results with which this research started. And well, I hope they are clear. before moving into the more recent results and the things we are currently working on, I would like to share a bit the ideas behind the proofs of these two results. Okay, so let me start with theorem one. Remember, what we have to show is that any connected network of pure bipartite states displays genuine multipartite non-locality. So the idea where I'm going to use a couple of different ingredients. Okay, the first ingredient is very well known. We are going to use the CHSH inequality. Okay, and we start with two parties, two inputs, two outputs. The only thing that is non-standard in this formula here is this might not be the form of the CHSH inequality everybody knows, but well, believe me that if you moreover use the condition that your conditional probability distributions are non-signaling, then you can rewrite this well-known inequality in this way here. Okay. Then another thing that we are going to use is the so-called Hardy's paradox. Okay, the Hardy's paradox in the originally this old paper originally devised by Hardy, what he proves there is that states that lead to probability distributions fulfilling this, okay, that this probability is strictly larger than zero and these three are zero, they have to be non-local. Okay, actually, now this is obvious if you look into the way I've written the CHSH inequality here, because of course, if this thing happens in here, then this inequality is violated. And Hardy's paper doesn't use this argument. He builds an argument of his own to show that whenever this holds, these distributions cannot be local. But actually, it's maybe easier to see it once one looks at the CHSH inequality written in this way. Okay? And actually, it's important for later that it is known that all pure states display this feature. There exist measurements such that this condition here holds, except for the maximally entangled state, which where it is proven that it is impossible. Okay. Okay, and the other ingredient we are going to use is this construction of Courchot, Almeida, and Athene. Okay, so the idea is they use this way of thinking of the CHSH inequality to obtain an inequality that detects genuine multipartite non-locality for three parties. Okay, and the idea is, well, you see, when I consider these terms here, I12 or I13, what we are doing is playing the CHSH game or using the CHSH inequality among parties one and two, conditioned on the third party having the input zero and the output zero. Okay? And the same here for this other expression, it's the same thing, but it's now one and three who are following the CHSH inequality and party two is fixed to input zero and output zero. Okay? And actually, it is not difficult to show that if you consider the sum of these two expressions minus this, this is a Bell inequality whose violation implies that this genuine multipartite non-local. Why is that? Because you see, it's sort of not difficult to see that if a distribution is bilocal, then it can only, at most, can violate one of, well, violate, I mean, can be, at most one of these two terms can be positive, okay? So, and that is the idea of violating the CHSH inequality. We are subtracting this term. So even though one of these terms might be positive, it actually the only term which can be positive is this one here. So, but we are subtracting it, so we are killing it. So for bilocal distributions, this can never be positive, okay? This is the idea here. Okay, so these are the three ingredients we are going to mix. And this is how we are going to construct now an inequality that is violated by all pure bipartite state networks, okay? Well, the notation here can be a mess. So I'm going to illustrate how the proof goes for this simple case of three parties. The ideas are the same in the general case, just the notation becomes much more complicated, okay? Well, so first of all, given any network, it is actually sufficient to consider a spanning tree, okay, of the corresponding graph. So for instance, in this case, I can neglect one link, the one, for instance, between parties two and three, because having a tree is enough, okay? Okay, then what we are going to use is we are going to consider inequalities for with in the setting of two inputs and two outputs per particle, okay? Not per party, okay? Because some parties, the number of particles each party holds changes, okay? So what we are going to have is two inputs and two outputs per particle. So in this, in the example I'm considering here of three parties, party one is going to have four inputs and four outputs because party one holds two particles, and parties two and three will have two inputs and two outputs, okay? And actually, so we can think that one receives two bits and has to output two bits as well. And actually, of course, party one could do a very complicated strategy in which he does collective measurements on these two particles depending on the value of these bits. But actually, it turns out it is enough that he measures individually each particle only depending on one of these bits. So this is not the most general strategy, but we are going to see that this is actually enough. Okay. So you see in the general case, each party will have 2 to the d, where d is the degree of its corresponding vertex in the tree. Okay, okay, and so because of what I just said, then this means that the whole conditional probability distribution is going to factorize between the psi and the phi part, okay? Which doesn't mean that the distribution is not GMNL, okay? Because this doesn't factorize in a cat 1 versus 2, 3, okay? Or 2 versus 1, 3, et cetera. Okay, so we are going to have a conditional probability distribution, which happens to be the product of these two conditional probability distribution, one that carries the strategies being done on psi and one that carries the strategies being done on phi. Okay, and now what we're going to do is lift the Courchot, Almeida and Affine inequality that I showed you before to this setting and show you that this distribution violates this inequality. So again, now things get a bit more complicated, but the idea is the same. So now what we have is expressions in which two parties are playing the CHSH game conditioned on some other input and output for the remaining part. Okay? And then combining these expressions cleverly, then again, one can see that this inequality can only be violated if you have a GMNL distribution. Okay? All bilocal distributions can never be positive for this, can never yield a positive number for this expression, okay? And now the final idea in the proof is that provided psi and phi are not the maximally entangled state, then there exist measurements such that the Hardy's paradox is achieved, okay? So then this means that a lot of cancellations are going to happen here because remember Hardy's paradox, certain elements of the conditional probability distribution are zero. And this is engineered in such a way that for an inequality, only the all inputs equal to zero and all outputs equal to zero survives, okay? Which remember, this is the product of the corresponding thing for the psi and the phi part, okay? But in Hardy's paradox, these are strictly positive, hence the value of the inequality is strictly positive, and then GMNL is proven. You see here, we have assumed that they are not sharing maximal entangled states, so the proof is not complete. Actually, in the case in which some node or all the nodes are maximally entangled have to be treated separately. So I'm very briefly mention what we do here. So let's stick for simplicity in this three-party case. And I suppose that one state, let's say psi, is maximally entangled. Then we cannot have a Hardy paradox distribution, but what we can use is this other result of this reference that shows that there exist measurements that lead to a fully non-local distribution according to this EPR2 decomposition from Elitsur, Popescu, and Rolich. This showed up this morning in Paul's talk. It referred to this as the weight. So here the idea is the same. We look at the distribution and we want to write it as a convex combination of a local distribution and a non-signaling distribution. What is particular about the maximally entangled state is that there exists a measurement strategy such that this weight is maximum. okay, is equal to one. Actually, I'm not being completely precise here because it exists a measurement strategy in which this is as close to one as possible. So, in, I mean, when you, in the paper, of course, we have to take into account some epsilons, but I mean, this works for simplicity here. I'm just writing this one. Okay, and then again, the idea is very similar. So now we implement this strategy on the maximal entangled state, okay, that leads to a fully non-local distribution, and we repeat Hardy's paradox strategy for the non-maximal entangled state. So then again, we obtain a conditional probability distribution, which is the product of these two objects, the distribution on psi and the distribution on phi. And well, we know that this is non-local because it comes from this Hardy's paradox strategy. And we know that this is not only non-local, but fully non-local. Okay? And then this allows this extra ingredient, now that this distribution here is fully non-local, allows one to see that this is in contradiction with P not being GMNL. Okay? The idea is, if this is fully, if this was bilocal, then the, by summing over certain inputs and then just looking in this part in here, the fact that this is fully non-local imposes that, that many partitions cannot be there in the convex combination of this bilocal state. Then the only ones that could be because of this term cannot be in order for this term to be non-local. This is very sketchily the idea. And then this allows to prove GMNL. Well, some states are maximally entangled and some states are not. Yeah, I'm just for simplicity showing the three-partite case. Okay? This is not the end because there remains one the case in which both states are maximally entangled. Okay? But this was actually the case that was known before in the reference I mentioned, and this indeed finishes the proof. So we have fortunately to consider these three different situations. Okay? No maximally entangled states, all states are maximally entangled states, or they are both. Okay. I would also like to give you, but this I'm going to do even much more sketchily, an idea of the proof of theorem two, that n minus one copies of a GME state leads to a GMNL distribution. The, this uses the previous theorem, okay? And somehow the idea is, well, considering precisely this this paper which completed the analysis of the original paper by Popescu, what we know is that for any GME state, there exists a measurement in any of the parties that for a certain outcome leaves the other parties, in this case, since we have three parties, leaves the other two parties with an entangled state. Okay? And this we can choose for any party. Okay? So now, very sketchily, the idea that we do here is, okay, well, now since we have copies, if you take two copies of this GME state, and if I do these strategies in here, well, this gives me, I take two copies of this, this gives me a network state like the one I had before. Okay? And then we can write Bell inequalities who only use the measurements and outcomes that lead to this construction in here. And then because this is GMNL, one can show that the two copies of this are GMNL. And this is why you need n minus one copies, because in the case I have n parties, then I do measurements on the remaining n minus two, such that each pair ends up with an entangled state, and then they have a star network when I take the n minus one copies. Okay, good. So I think I still have a bit of time, and I'd like to finish by discussing the ongoing work that we are doing now, which is going beyond pure states. Okay, so this, the result here somehow closes the situation for pure states, okay? And now we want to know what happens if they share entanglement, if we have node-to-node entanglement, but in mixed form, okay? Well, obviously, since both the sets of GME and GMNL states are open, their four established properties are robust to some amount of noise, okay? We still, if they put a bit of noise, we will still violate our Bell inequality, okay? But maybe the, what we had before is a really strong statement, is any pure bipartite state network is GME, any pure bipartite state network is GMNL. So does the same happen when we have node-to-node mixed entanglement, when we have some noise? If the nodes share entanglement, then is this enough to have GME? if the nodes share non-locality, is this enough to have GMNL? Well, the answer is no. Okay? This really crucially depends on sharing pure states. And the first results I can mention here is that, well, there exist connected bipartite networks with mixed node-to-node entanglement. All the edges are correspond to entanglement, but whenever this is in mixed state form, it can happen that the state is not GME. Okay? And the same happens for non-locality. So we can have a connected network in which all the edges amount to sharing non-local mixed states, yet the whole n-partite state is not genuinely multipartite non-local. So these two properties result in the fact that the ability to display GME or GMNL in mixed bipartite state networks, then it's going to depend both on the quality of entanglement shared and on the network of the topology, contrary to the pure state case. Okay. So I wanted to show you a very simple example, because this actually, one can see this in very easy and simple examples. So suppose now that all edges, that all links amount to sharing a 2-qubit isotropic state, okay? Like the simplest noise model one could think of. This is just some the maximally entangled 2-qubit state mixed with some white noise. Okay, then it's well known that if this noise parameter I'm going to use p is larger or equal to 1/3, then the state is still entangled. Okay? Well, actually, if you think this is not such of a reduction, thinking that all the edges amount to 2-qubit isotropic states, because you think about it, since all 2-qubit entangled state can be transformed by LOCC to an isotropic state, then the question of whether all 2-qubit networks are GME, this is boils down, this happens if and only if all 2-qubit isotropic networks are GME. Well, and what happens is that this is not the case, and you can see it in the simplest case of three parties. Okay, so here you have two different cases of three parties when we only have two edges or where we have three edges. And while these two networks are fully separable, when the edges are separable, if P is less than or equal to 1/3, then the ranges in which they are GME change, and actually, more interestingly, for some values of p larger than 1/3, they are nevertheless biseparable. So in this case, we can show that this state is biseparable if the noise parameter is below this number here. Well, you see this other network, we can show it is GME if the noise parameter is above this number. So whenever this state is biseparable, this one, this network here, can be GME. Okay? Maybe not surprising, because here we have an extra link that somehow reinforces the entanglement. Nevertheless, they are both biseparable for some value of p, which is strictly larger than 1/3. So even though the pairs share entanglement, it is not good enough to observe GME, and hence cannot be also good enough to observe GMNL. Okay. However, remember that I already said that this is something that happens. One can see that sufficiently many copies of these networks become GME for any value of the noise parameter, which is larger than 1/3. Okay, so another result I'd like to share with you of this ongoing work is that another thing you can do with these networks is well, we have seen that they cannot be GME, and hence they cannot be GMNL. But can we have also, if we know that entanglement and non-locality are not equivalent, so one could ask whether we have the situation in which we have GME networks but not GMNL. Okay? And one can construct examples of this using these bipartite state networks for any number of parties. Okay. This result is not new. The examples of this were known before. Actually, these are the results in these papers in here. So somehow here, using our bipartite state networks, we can provide new constructions of this phenomena of genuinely multipartite entangled states, which are nevertheless not genuinely multipartite non-local. Actually, the construction is kind of simple of one possible construction. just to show you some example, you have this star network, okay, in which all links correspond to maximal entangled states except one, okay, which is the one that is here in red. So whenever this happens, one can show that this state is not GMNL whenever this noisy link is local, okay? But this is according to Svetlicny's definition, which is not the one we are using, okay? But this analogy is somehow interesting because if this noisy link is not only local, but non-steerable, then one can show that then this state is not GMNL in the standard definition, okay? However, on the other hand, if the noisy link is any entangled isotropic state, so for any p larger than 1/3, for instance, then the state is GME. Okay, so then this gives you enough value of the noise parameter to have a non-steerable state in here in such a way that this is not GMNL, but the state is still entangled, so this whole thing here is GME. Okay, and just to finish, I want to tell you a bit of one last question. So as we have said before, I mean, if you consider a fixed network, then it has to be, it's GME and GMNL has to be robust to some noise, okay? But now think of this the other way around. You are not fixed to some network, but because of your ability to create entangled pairs, you are fixed to a certain value of the noise parameter. So maybe we could expect that if this noise parameter is high enough, is close to one, I cannot prepare perfect pure entanglement, but very good, then maybe we could ensure GME, okay, for every network, as I said, provided that this noise is small enough. Well, actually, it turns out that this is not the case, okay? And this shows a limitation of bipartite state networks, okay? The idea is that for any value of the noise parameter, which is strictly smaller than one, it doesn't matter how close to one, but as long as it is smaller than one, then there is a connected bipartite state network of isotropic states that are not GME. Okay? So if whenever we cannot prepare perfectly pure states, we have some limitation. At some point, we cannot get for free GME for as many parties as we want, even if our preparation is almost perfect. At some point, we will fail and we won't be able to have GME. Okay. Nevertheless, there is a way out, which is taking sufficiently many copies. If we can somehow distribute more copies of this noisy entanglement and access them coherently, then the network state becomes GME. Okay. So with this, I arrive to my conclusions. I hope I have convinced you that bipartite state networks provide an experimentally feasible way of preparing non-classical multipartite quantum states, which is worth exploring. And in this sense, we have shown that pure bipartite state networks are always not only genuinely multipartite entangled, but also genuinely multipartite non-local, independently of the amount of entanglement shared and the network topology. This is not the case when we have mixed bipartite state networks. In this case, the displaying these features depends both on the amount of entanglement shared and on the network topology. Well, so I hope I have convinced you or hinted you to the fact that this class of multipartite states is an interesting operationally motivated subclass, which has well-defined mathematical properties that can be used as a platform to study the relation of entanglement and non-locality in many body systems. So as an application of these ideas, for instance, we have used results regarding these networks to show that sufficiently many copies of any GME state leads to GMNL. Also, we have given new constructions of states that are GME but not GMNL. Actually, we are now working on this. I mean, this should be taken with a bit of a grain of salt because we are finishing these things, but I think one can use this actually to prove something stronger, which are examples of GMNL superactivation. Okay, so these states are not GMNL at the single copy level, but if you take many copies of them, then they can display genuine multipartite non-locality. Yeah. And the last thing I presented is a limitation of bipartite state networks. Okay? The slightest form of noise can prevent from displaying genuine multipartite entanglement and hence as well genuine multipartite non-locality. But this is what we are working as of now. So well, forgive me if I don't say more about this. I hope I can tell more about this in the next conference. Thank you very much for your attention.